Hi, good evening. You're watching NDTV. I'm Rishika Barua. The big story today is Unlock 1.0. Over the course of the last 2 hours, we've tried to break down for our viewers what's open, what's not. Offices will be open, malls, restaurants. Life as we know it, the new normal, will slowly begin to kick in. But what should you and shouldn't you do as India continues to ease restrictions? Well, who better to answer these questions than the director of the All India Institute of Medical Sciences, Dr. Randeep Guleria. Appreciate you so much for being with us this evening. And over the course of the next half an hour, Dr. Guleria, we'll pick your brains because it's been such a significant development today. Unlock 1.0. So the first time that the government has announced a whole host of, eases in the lockdown measure. So as we as we talk about those, let me first begin by asking you, Unlock 1.0, as a doctor, as a medical professional, as an expert, you know, it will present itself with new challenges, won't it? Do you fear an additional burden on the healthcare system?
So there are going to be additional challenges as we have a new phase one coming in, because that will mean that there is more chances of individual going out and meeting each other. And the challenges that we have is that how can we in this era then be able to work in keeping the number of cases down, prevent a spike, and also not have a huge surge so that our hospitals get overburdened. And to do that, there has to be a lot of individual participation, understanding of each individual's responsibility, because as we open our economy and as people start coming back to this new normal, they must understand that with this new normal, there is also a huge amount of responsibility that rests on their shoulder. Whether it's maintaining social distancing when you are going out, even if you're going to a shopping area, or wearing a mask as throughout the day whenever you are traveling or when you are out, maintaining social distancing and or physical distancing in restaurants or in your office. All of these have to kick in and it has to become a habit, because if we don't do that, we will actually promote the spread of the infection.
But you know, Dr. Guleria, staying with Unlock 1.0, it was widely believed by experts, including yourself, that this period of lockdown was essential for India to be able to prep for a pandemic, for our healthcare system, for our doctors, for frontline workers to understand what they're dealing with. Do you believe as a medical expert that we have a grip on the situation today?
I think so. If you were to look at how things were when the lockdown first came in, we were actually not as prepared as we are today. So let's look at it from multiple factors. When it comes to testing, we were just doing around 10 to 20,000 tests a day. We are now doing more than 110,000 tests a day or 120,000 tests a day, because we've been able to ramp up our testing facilities, bring in a large number of labs which were not doing viral testing for this new coronavirus. Hospital services has been streamlined in terms of having COVID care facilities, COVID hospitals, COVID ICUs. We've managed to really ramp up the oxygen supply even up to a district hospital level, and also get more and more ventilators on board. We've also been able to develop strategies of training our doctors, developing telemedicine or teleconsultation, so that doctors even in remote area can talk to specialists in tertiary care hospitals and be able to really get the knowledge that they need to manage these patients. Our knowledge of the disease also has actually improved, right? And we are understanding more about this virus than what we were able to understand a few weeks ago, and that has helped us to develop better treatment strategies.
Right, that's very reassuring coming from somebody like you, who believes that we're much better equipped to deal with the pandemic, to deal with the virus that we still know very little of, but we're definitely, in a much better position than, say, we were 2 months ago. But having said that, India has seen its biggest single day spike in COVID cases today, Doctor. Over 8,000 new cases. We're reporting 1.8 lakh cases of the coronavirus on a day we've announced Unlock 1.0. The big question that is on everyone's mind: how soon can India flatten the curve? What's your assessment?
So that's the big challenge that we have, that although the number of cases, the rise in the number of cases has been slow, our doubling time has not been as rapid as it happened in the certain Western countries, but we haven't seen a decline in the number of cases. There still continues to be a slow, steady rise in the number of cases as we go over the last few weeks. And therefore, we need to really work more aggressively, especially on the hot spots, because if you start really analyzing the data critically, you realize that the rise in number of cases is occurring only in a few areas in the country, and they account for almost 70 to 80% of our cases, and their steep rise is occurring only in these areas. So I think there has to be an aggressive effort to really do some micro planning to see why are the cases rising here, what can we do, and how aggressive can we be in terms of isolation, quarantine, maintaining social distance. A lot of contact tracing needs to be done there,
right,
so that these areas, the cases come down from these areas, and these areas are sort of contained, and the infection doesn't leak out from these areas to other parts of the country.
It's very interesting, because what your assessment is, you know, is exactly in line with the strategy that the government seems to have devised. So there are 13 cities broadly that account for over 85% of India's COVID cases. That's the government's assessment. And if, you know, Unlock 1.0 is closely analyzed, they are looking to manage the infections now at a local level instead of having, you know, a pan-India lockdown, you know, like what we were facing. But having said that, you know, does the rise in the number of cases concern you? The single biggest spike is something that we use all too often. There are also indications that, you know, in July, India will peak. Do you agree with that assessment?
So I do agree that the rise in cases is something that we need to be concerned about. But we've had this data coming from for a number of weeks. We had this single rise, and we said that we have crossed this mark or that mark, the 50,000 mark or things like that. So that has happened, and that is happening in terms of the single day spike, in terms of cumulative number of cases. It is a cause of concern, because we are still not seeing a downward trend. And that is what I feel is a worrying part. But the heartening part, as you yourself said, is that we haven't seen that there is a widespread disease in most parts of our country. It's localized. And if we focus on these localized areas, we could have some degree of back to normal or an economical growth in those areas where the disease has not really had a big foothold. But at the same time, I would say that in all these areas, we have to have a very strong surveillance system, yes, whether it's testing people or looking for people who are presenting with acute severe respiratory illnesses, so that we are able to pick up any new occurrence of cases in these cold areas, and we are able to act quickly so that they don't become a hotspot.
You know, speaking of good news, we're talking, of course, of, you know, 13 cities that are accounting for 85% of cases, which means that there can be more restrictions in other areas. The recoveries versus the new cases gap seems to be narrowing, Dr. Guleria. For the first time today, while, of course, India has reported over 8,000 cases of the coronavirus, we have reported 11,000 recoveries, which is more than the number of you know, of daily cases that we're reporting on. What do you make of this narrowing gap? Do you believe that if this becomes a trend, we could be flattening the curve?
Yes, so I think what we need to really understand is that there are two things. One is the number of cases. The other is the number of people who are recovering and the number of mortalities or death that we're having or number of ICU admissions. If we really look at the data critically, India has not had that many large number of patients who are requiring ventilatory support. So our serious patients are very few in terms of those who are requiring ventilatory support or those who are critically ill in the ICU. What that means is that the bulk of patients, that is maybe 95 to 97% of patients who are currently admitted, have moderate disease, and majority of them will therefore recover, and our recovery percentage will actually increase much more over the next few days.
Right.
Because these patients are going to recover and add on to that number that we're talking of. And that is the heartening part, that unlike what has been seen in the Western world, our critically ill patients and our mortality continues to be low. The numbers will be more because of the population that we have, and we will see a larger number of cases. But I think the focus has to be in trying to decrease the number of deaths.
But, you know, a follow-up to that, given that, you know, the number of critical cases and mortalities, thankfully, in India have been lower than what we've seen globally. You know, there is an increasing trend now of people being asked to home isolate or home quarantine. Even patients who've tested positive for the coronavirus, for instance, who exhibit no symptoms or mild symptoms, are being asked to home quarantine. What are some of the do's and don'ts, Dr. Guleria? And in what condition, should a doctor recommend home quarantine and a patient accept it?
So as the number increases, there is a concern that we should not sort of block our hospitals or choke up our hospitals with patients who are relatively stable and actually don't need to be in the hospital. They're just there because they were COVID positive. Therefore, to decongest the hospital and take in really the sick patients, and for doctors to then focus on these sick patients who may have severe disease or who may have associated comorbidities which may contribute to a higher mortality, we need to be able to send those who have mild disease into an isolation facility, which could be home isolation.
Right.
But these individuals need to understand their responsibility out there. They are positive patients and they can give the infection to the other members of the family. They can spread it in their own community. Therefore, the isolation has to be very, very strict. They should confine themselves to a room with an attached toilet. Make sure that there is only one caregiver who provides them their needs.
Right.
And the sanitization of the room should be done
properly. So a whole host of rules and regulations that govern home isolation. But, the big question that's on everyone's mind, given that, we're reporting over 1.8 lakh cases today, is India in the community transmission stage?
So that is something that is what you could sort of, it's an issue of semantics, that's what I feel. Because if you start looking at a country level, as you rightly said, a large part of a country, the number of cases are very few or they're declining. And obviously, there is no community spread happening as far as most of the country is concerned.
Right.
However, in these hotspots where the number of cases is increasing, there is a chance that there is some local spread occurring there, which is the reason why in these areas the cases are continuing to increase. And that is why, like I said in the beginning, contact tracing, looking at people with symptoms, isolating them, and making sure that we don't have a spread of infection in those areas.
So you are suggesting that there could be community transmission in hotspot areas, in containment zones?
So there is a possibility that may be happening, and that may be contributing to the increasing number of cases.
Okay. Dr. Guleria, let's come down to the nitty-gritties. Today there's new rules, new guidelines. What about restaurants, eateries, people, who might want to be stepping out, given that restaurants are now going to be open? Of course, physical distancing will be followed, masks, etc., mandatory. Is it safe to eat out? Would you recommend it?
So if you're in a hotspot or in a city like Delhi, I would definitely not recommend it. I would say it's safe if you were to still stay at home and eat, because we still have a large number of cases and number of cases in Delhi are increasing. But if you're in an area where the number of cases are few, they're coming down, I would say with maintaining social distancing, with regular hand washing and making sure that there are very few people in the restaurant and there is no real physical contact happening, you could consider that. But if it's really something that you can avoid, then why should one take a chance? It's better to avoid it for a few days or weeks, and then maybe if things are better, then do that.
Do you then believe that it's perhaps a little premature to open restaurants, hotels, malls?
So again, you have to balance everything. We've had a lockdown for quite a long time. It's affected the economy. It's also affected the daily wage people, the people who are marginalized, the low socioeconomic sector. For them, their earnings are getting affected, and that is having a big effect as far as these individuals are concerned.
It's a very thin balance that the government has to strike. It's a question of survival either way, you can say. But doctor, I'd like to bring you to the other big issue that's dominating the news, which is traveling in a pandemic. More trains are going to open up in this next phase. We've seen domestic flights resume, and we've seen that there have been reports of infections on board. People who are landing in destination states have been tested positive for the COVID-19. What would you say to people boarding flights, those who must absolutely, engage in any kind of traveling? Should they mandatorily, home quarantine, self-quarantine, irrespective of whatever the rules and regulations in each state are? What would you like to tell people boarding a flight?
So like you rightly said, you should avoid travel unless it's really essential. A lot of work can be done from home. and it may not be something that is advisable right now. So I would say traveling for a holiday and all is totally out. But at the same time, there are people who are stranded at different areas because of the lockdown, want to come home or have other issues in terms of their family. So traveling becomes important for them.
Yes.
They have to take all the precautions that have already been put up by the government while traveling. And at the same time, it would be worthwhile if they were to maintain some degree of social distance or stay at home for a few days because of the fact that there may have been some exposure while they were traveling.
But, you know, just to ask you, just to narrow the scope of this question even further, if you have to board a flight, if you're stranded or for whatever emergency you have to board a flight, you know, what would be the two or three things that you would advise a passenger to do? We've seen passengers flying in PPE kits, passengers wearing helmets. So everyone's trying to, you know, innovate in a certain sense. But what would you say are the two or three most important things?
So you must understand that how the infection spreads. It spreads either through droplets or through surfaces. So if you're wearing a mask and you're also wearing a face shield, then at least the droplet spread from one individual to the other can be decreased to a large extent, because if both individuals are wearing a mask and a face shield, it's very unlikely that the virus can then cross this barrier
right.
and reach the other individual. Second is to avoid touching a lot of surfaces because the virus can settle on surfaces. Regularly keep using a hand sanitizer so that your hands are not getting infected by what you touch. And at the same time, avoid touching your face with your hands
right.
while you're traveling, and then wash your hands properly once you get off the flight.
Right. So face shields, masks, and of course, minimizing contact wherever it is possible. But, you know, Dr. Guleria, as we end this conversation this evening, the other big question that's on everyone's mind, you know, every doctor, including yourself, has time and time again said, look, prevention is the best cure available right now. So as restrictions are eased, as we enter lockdown, unlock 1.0, as lockdowns are lifted, how far are we from a vaccine? You know, what's the timeline that you're looking at?
So you see, if you start looking at a vaccine, it has multiple steps. One is to have a candidate vaccine. There are more than 100 candidate vaccines. India is working on four. And there is a lot of research going on in India also as far as vaccine development is concerned. But once you have a candidate vaccine and you've made a vaccine, it has to go into trials to show that it is efficacious.
Yes.
How much protection does a vaccine give? If a vaccine is giving only 10 to 20% protection, it's of no use.
Hmm.
You want a vaccine to give you at least 70 to 80% protection. Then you want to make sure that this vaccine is safe. It itself does not cause any side effects. And we've had vaccine in the 70s and 80s, which caused neurological side effects. So that is the other important question.
Right.
And finally, mass production of a vaccine, millions of doses. And you have to prioritize who will you give it first to, because you're not going to have enough doses on day one to vaccinate everyone who should be vaccinated.
Mm. So the timeline, in a certain sense, you're saying
yes,
is still uncertain.
My mind is going to at least take about another 8 to 9 months. Only by early next year should we actually be, if we're lucky to have, we should
so you're
be
saying
able to...
if we're lucky, we're looking at a vaccine by early next year. You know, that brings me to the other contentious question these days, one of hydroxychloroquine. There's been a lot of conversation around it. Now, the recent Lancet study said that there is, you know, a high risk of mortality or arrhythmia, which is irregular heartbeat, that's been linked with the use of hydroxychloroquine, so much so that the World Health Organization has put a hold on the trial, the global trial of hydroxychloroquine as a possible cure for COVID-19. This, as India still administers HCQ, so much so that we give it to our frontline workers, we give it to, you know, anybody who's suffering COVID or anybody who's a contact of a COVID positive case. What's your stand on this?
So there are two things to understand. One is the use of it as a treatment for severely ill patients. The other is prophylaxis and for treatment for mild disease. Now, the Lancet study was given for very sick patients and they were getting multiple drugs, including other antibiotics. And it's well known that combination of hydroxychloroquine with other drugs, which have also a potential cardiac effect, can be cumulative. And this can lead to higher chance of arrhythmias. The WHO, as an abundant precaution, they did not find any reason to say that the side effects are more.
Mm-hmm.
Based on that study, decided to withhold it for the time being. But when we looked at our data, and this is data looked at by doctors at AIIMS, by ICMR, by other hospitals, it clearly showed that when it's used as prophylaxis in healthcare workers, the side effects were minimal, and we are quite comfortable that if it's used as a standalone treatment, it's quite safe. I myself have been using it for more than 20 years and I found it to be very, very safe. At the same time, they also showed, the data also suggested, or there was tendencies to suggest, that those doctors or healthcare workers who were taking hydroxychloroquine had lesser COVID-19 infection as compared to those who were not, considering that they were working in a similar area.
No, but that's prevention. But Dr. Guleria, what about patients, COVID patients who are being administered hydroxychloroquine? Because I think the study was conducted on COVID patients, if I'm not wrong.
So that's what I said. For prophylaxis, there is some data. The other data is for mild illness, because hydroxychloroquine is a drug which prevents viral replication. So when you are able to give it early, when the viral replication has just started, you may have a better effect. But if you give it late, when viral replication has already happened, then the efficacy of the drug is not going to be that much. So it's also when you give the drug and in which state you give it that is important. And that is important for various other antiviral drugs also. That if you give it late, for example, the drugs that we give for influenza, oseltamivir, which is known as Tamiflu, it's effective only again if it's given in the early stage. If for influenza, you give the same drug 4 or 5 days later when the person is very sick, it is not effective, because it's just, you've sort of missed the boat by giving it at that point
and
in time.
Very, very briefly, doctor, before we let you go, Remdesivir, now a US pharma giant is seeking marketing authorization for Remdesivir in India. That's touted as a potential cure as well.
Yes, so Remdesivir is a drug where there have been recent data. Again, this data is in more severe patients, and it just tends to show that there is a decrease in the hospital stay. There is a decrease of about 4 days, but again does not show any mortality benefit. The study did not show that those who got Remdesivir had better survival as compared to those who did not get it. So here again, the data is not that strong, but is an indication that it may be useful.
All right. Dr. Guleria, as always, you've been so kind taking on all our questions, clearing our doubts, for allowing us to pick your brain, yet again, as India goes into Unlock 1.0. You've been very kind in answering a lot of those very important questions and clearing the air around several others. Thank you so much for joining us this evening. That's all we have time for. Slipping into a short break. We'll be back with the news on the other side. Stay tuned.